It is the fifth day of Christmas, and the church continues to celebrate it. Despite the short attention span we see out of the world, on December 23rd, I'm going down an aisle and still looking for my favorite gingerbread cookies for Christmas Day. I go to the seasonal aisle, and the seasonal aisle for Christmas is empty. They already emptied it out, and they have a little sign on there for where all the Valentine's Day came. And yesterday, I saw, I kid you not, a Cadbury egg. I saw a Cadbury egg. Everyone's moving on, but it's still Christmas in the church. It's still Christmas. We have so much still to celebrate, so much still to reflect on. And you might be asking by looking at the readings at the beginning of the prayers this morning, but it's still Christmas. We haven't heard one darn thing yet about Mary or Joseph or angels or shepherds or baby Jesus. So what gives? Well, what gives? We get the Christmas story on Christmas Eve that has all the angels and the shepherds and baby Jesus that tells us what happened. And then on Christmas morning and today, we get this wonderful passage from the Gospel of John that tells us what that story means. So the Gospel of John, that reading we just heard, is really a Christmas reading because it tells us about the incarnation, which is the true Christmas miracle that we're celebrating here in Christmas. About Jesus, the Word made flesh, who came to dwell among us. The Word made flesh that dwells among us. And what that means is that God has come through that child, through Jesus in that manger. God is taking on human form and being with us. And that is such a wonderful thing because it shows us that God, when the going gets tough in this world, doesn't abandon this world, doesn't abandon humanity. In fact, God goes the other direction, comes into the world, into that child to be with us and to love us. And so God experiences life as human beings. So God has moments through Christ Jesus where he experiences mourning the loss of a friend. There's that story where Lazarus raises from the dead. But before that, it says that Jesus wept, that he mourned for his friend. Jesus experiences what it's like to be really mad. So God through Jesus experiences what it's like to be really mad when he turns over those tables in the temple. God experiences what it's like to be tempted and knows what we experience when we're tempted. Is that story of Jesus in the desert and the temptations from the devil. God in Jesus experiences what it's like to be tempted. And then knows what it's like to experience physical injury on that cross and then die. God knows what it's like to be a human being. And that's because God came to us in that child and as a human being. On that first Christmas. And so, when we think, no one knows what I'm feeling right now. I feel abandoned. I feel like there's no one there. Christmas, the incarnation tells us, you know what? God does. God knows what you're going through, and God is with you through it all. And the other thing we can't forget is that God also knows what it's like to have fun, to have a good time with family and friends that are like involved with us in our suffering and in our joys. And that happens through the incarnation and Christmas when God comes into the world as a human being. And as I've said before, wait, there's more. It gets even better. That in that incarnation, God and humanity are united together in Jesus. Human nature and divine nature come together. And that is the first of the creation verse. That's the second big step in God's rescue mission of humanity. God not abandon us, not only does God know us, not only does God love us, that He's got a plan to save us. Which brings me to point two that we have here in the Gospel of John this morning, what that child in the manger represents. It's that child in the manger is the light that shines through the darkness. Jesus is the light that shines through the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. I'm reminded of when I was in high school. I was in ninth grade. My dad tells me, we got to move to Missouri. We lived in Pennsylvania. We lived in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. In the middle of my ninth grade, we had to move the whole way to Pennsylvania. I was not happy about it. Major culture shocks. I had never seen a high school student wear a cowboy hat to school for real. I believe it or not, at the time, I had never tried this because in grade we got it.
Thank you.